comprehend and to kind of assimilate in my consciousness, what do you mean, my husband, the father of my children, is now going to be a woman? You know, that was tough to understand, but you don't have to understand something just to accept it and to be kind about it. You know, we're all in this together, and there are so many different variations of the human condition, and we just have to love each other, accept each other. That's part of the book. It's not a tell-all. It's a book about love, forgiveness, compassion, tolerance, and just moving forward, you know, and being kind to each other. So Bruce and I remain friends. And then Caitlin and I are now friends. Caitlin's first wife, Christy, her kids, my stepchildren, their children. We were all together for Thanksgiving a few days ago.
Wow.
And yeah, so it's wonderful, you know, just to have that kind of expansive heart and expansive sense of understanding that, you know, we're all, again, you know, we're all fallible. That was the one big lesson I learned with Elvis. Is that, you know, we do people a great disservice, celebrated individuals, famous people, by putting them on a pedestal and not allowing them to be human. You know, everyone is human. And Elvis felt an intense loneliness in heart because he felt like people knew him as Elvis Presley on the marquee, not as the human entity. And as he would say to me, the little boy, you know, from Tupelo in Memphis, Tennessee, with the little chicken neck, who wears a high collar to hide his little skinny neck, not because he thinks he's cool. So, you know, I just was afforded so many opportunities in life, and it was difficult for me to go back and excavate all those memories and relive them and feel them deeply enough to articulate them effectively enough so that the reader would get a sense of what my life truly was like. But it was a crazy ride, you know, all the way to tonight and meeting all you wonderful people and seeing some other familiar faces. So, you know, I'm grateful for every moment. I'm open to questions because I know a lot of people have a lot of questions. Like, did you have any idea? And the short answer to that is no. Not a clue. You know, I had no clue about Bruce until he came to me that day. And, you know, he was completely this Malibu jock, you know, that was in the water every day, you know, surfing, jet skiing, flying his airplane. You know, this was a manly, manly man in every sense of the word. So there was not, I had no clue, not a clue. So I was totally devastated when he came to me. And funnily enough, he was at my house. She was at my house, kind of politically correct here. She was at my house night before last because she's writing a book. And I'm helping her to gather photos for her book. And it was interesting because she wasn't around when the boys were growing up. You know, she went down that Kardashian rabbit hole and wasn't around, you know, for a long time. But I raised my boys to be forgiving and loving and embracing, and they have embraced Caitlin, and they're, you know, they're there for her. And so anyway, she's going through all these photos, and, well, where's the pictures of Brandon and Brody? I said, well, you know, all due respect, you weren't here. You weren't a part of their growing up. And she kind of winced and went, yeah, I guess not, you know. But she had very little kind of, she's accountable, but she doesn't quite, she was so riddled with her own turmoil that she kind of didn't know how painful it was for other people that she wasn't there. And I said, you know, it was pretty devastating when you told me you wanted to be a woman. Oh, nah, come on. She still talks like Bruce, by the way. She's like, still got the Bruce Jenner voice. And, oh, nah, come on, you know, you were fine. I said, no, it was really painful. Really? I said, yeah, you know, I was very happily married to you. So even all these years later, you know, she still kind of is trying to come to terms with just the journey of her life as well. So it's been a crazy life. I felt an obligation to life itself to write this book. Because I thought, you know, like again, the show of hands, anybody else? No, all right, I gotta write the book. So does anybody have questions? I'm happy to answer.
So yes. Had you kept a diary?
I had little musings. I had not a day-to-day diary. But I would, being a writer and a lyricist, I would, you know, write down little thoughts and kind of meandering thoughts and that kind of thing. This brings up a good point, though, because I waited all these years because I wanted to carve out my own existence, you know, create my own sense of self, have my own career, carve out my own identity before I ever dared to write about these incredible people that I've known and loved in my life. You know, I thought it was important not to ever
be accused of exploiting those relationships. I waited until almost 40 years after Elvis's death, 11 years after my divorce from David, and, you know, 32 years after leaving Bruce, and then a year and a half after his coming out with his announcement that he was Caitlin. So, can't accuse. And I'm donating the proceeds to St. Jude Children's Hospital. Oh, yeah.
That's right.
Linda,
I have to bless you publicly here because I think we should all acknowledge something she said earlier. What a tremendous gift you gave your two sons. Because most partners in soured relationships castrate and castigate the other partner. But you gave your sons a spirit of forgiveness, which we don't see a lot. And I think that's pretty tremendous.
Well, thank you for acknowledging that. One of my favorite adages is, forgiveness is the fragrance the flower sheds on the heel that crushes it. And I think that's something for all of us to kind of, you know, mull about in our minds. Like, it's not even for the other person and the perceived offense. Or it's for yourself. You know, you just don't want to be burdened with that.
And they don't have a burden.
No, they're so great. I'm so proud of my sons because they truly accept Caitlin. They'll never get those Hallmark moments back, you know, the father and son moments that I wish they could have had. They'll never get those back. But, you know, they've had other blessings in their lives, and I've always tried to imbue in them, your perspective on life is your gift to yourself. You know, you can view the glass half empty and view it half full. I'd rather see life through rose-colored glasses. Call me Pollyanna any day of the week. You know, it's a nice existence and a perception that I've carved out for myself.
Where are your sons now?
In Malibu. They both bought properties 5 minutes one direction, 5 minutes the other direction.
Wow.
So I feel great. They're surfers, so where are you going to go but Malibu?
Of course.
Except Australia. That's a little too far. So I feel very blessed. And I have a little 16-month-old granddaughter who is just the light of my life. I'm just totally besotted by her. I have to tell you this. So I thought of every stripper name in the book to not be called Grandma. Poppy Bane. But I just said, Grandma? I don't know. I don't like that. That sounds like my grandmother. So I was thinking of all these little different names, you know, like Trixie and Bubbles and Pinky. So she finally came up with Lala, my great nephew, Jennifer's little nephew, and my great nephew. Mason came up with the name Lala, so I thought that's perfect, because when I write lyrics, composers will send me la 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 la, and I write the words to the la la la, so I thought that's perfect. So I said to Caitlin, so what do you want to be called, Caitlin? You know, Caitlin's 6'2", and she's lovely, you know, she's just lovely now, and she says, Boom Boom. There's a stripper name I didn't think of. So Caitlin is Boom Boom. I'm going to have to instruct little Eva, my granddaughter, don't say that really loud in public. So any other questions? Or
are there any lyrics that you wrote during that time that we would know? Or?
Very good question. All the lyrics that I've written have either been inspired by my life circumstance, some of the things that I've gone through, other people having confided in me. But if you go through the book, I chose to put lyrics between each chapter because, one, I wanted to show I'm more than just somebody, other people that I've been with, or, you know, you want to show that your career has meant something, and my songwriting career has certainly superseded my acting career or modeling or anything like that. So I did put lyrics between each chapter, and if you go back, you'll read I Have Nothing from The Bodyguard, which we got nominated for an Academy Award for Best Song in a Film. That song was definitely inspired by my living with Elvis, because I knew what it was like to live with the biggest male diva of all time. So I had to write this lyric around Whitney Houston, who was the female diva in the movie Bodyguard. So, you know, I took some of the happenings and, you know, some of my feelings of having lived with Elvis and wrote about it in The Bodyguard, like, stay in my arms if you dare, or must I imagine you there? Because it was a challenge, you know, to be with someone who was that larger than life, you know, someone who was such a huge rock star. So
life was able to become so poetic.
Yeah. So well, you know, and someone asked me earlier, you know, how did, where are you? Anyway, she was asking me about you know, what my recollections were as a child. And I think I always saw the world through a poet's eyes. You know, I always was just so aware of light and color and texture and fragrance and feelings, you know, and other people's, you know. I think most poets and most lyricists are inordinately kind of empathetic, you know, sometimes to your own, you know, to your own detriment, you know, and so I feel like I always did see life, you know, through those eyes, though, that was, you know, the way it is. Any other questions? Kelly, aren't you curious about anything?
I know everything.
Oh, you know it all. You can answer these questions.
That's right. Jennifer?
Yeah,
Jess?
Okay, Linda, is there anybody you would like to write with now, like in this day and age?
Sure. Lots of people. I just wrote a song that if you guys go online, there's a kid from Ireland named Eamon McChrystal.
Yeah.
And Eamon and Rita Wilson, Tom Hanks' wife, Eamon and Rita Wilson and Chloe Agnew. I don't know if she's related to Spiro Agnew or not. No, she's Irish too, so not. But the three of them recorded a song that I just wrote called Pray for Peace.
Oh, right.
It's such a timely lyric, you know, for the moment. You know, it's just, it's a beautiful kind of thought, if I do say so myself. So it's a song called Pray for Peace, and I just wrote that with Bernie Herms. He did the music and I did the lyric.
Oh, nice.
And my son Brandon, by the way, I may as well throw this out there.
Yeah,
Brandon Jenner has a new EP out, 5 songs, and it's called I Believe. And he put it out on Instagram and said, listen, everybody around the world, please send me a video. What do you believe in? And he got women from Afghanistan, you know, and from Iran, from Turkey, from Japan, from Sweden, all over the world, people sent him these videos. I believe in love. I believe in friendship. I believe in kindness. I believe in humanity. So Brandon wrote this beautiful lyric, and the first video is called I Believe. So Brandon Jenner, iTunes, YouTube, look him up. I'm really proud of him though, because Caitlin and I, Bruce, aka Caitlin and I, call him our little Gandhi, you know, because he's just such a good human being. It gets complicated because Brody, my son Brody's fiance, is named Caitlin. Bruce, could you pick another name? So, but anyway, that Caitlin and I call him Gandhi. He's such a good kid, so a good 35-year-old kid. Any other questions?
Tell us about Lisa Marie. You said you had time with her.
Lisa Marie, I adored. I played Santa to her every Christmas for the nearly 5 years that Elvis and I lived together at Graceland. She was with us every holiday, like every summer she would come and stay with us at Graceland, go on the road with us. She'd come to Vegas every time he had an engagement there. So she was like my first practice, you know, before I had kids. And then came Jennifer, and that was my further practice for having my children. But, you know, I absolutely adored her. And then when Elvis passed away, he and I had been broken up for 8 months. I broke up with him 8 months before he passed away. Knowing, honestly, no self-aggrandizement, but I just knew that he was not long for this world. And I didn't want to be the one to find him, no matter how hard I tried to keep him alive. So he passed away 8 months after we left, after we broke up. And Lisa Marie called me one day, and she was the one who called me to tell me he had passed away. And you know, she would call and check in from time to time anyway. But we were very close then. Then we lost touch. Then we reconnected. Then we lost touch. Then we reconnected again. So presently, we're not in touch. She's going through a few things in her life, so we're not in touch right now. But my door is always open to her. She's, you know, she was a wonderful memory for me, and I just adored her. And you know, the person that Elvis loved most in the world. So, yes.
I was in Memphis when you were with Elvis in Memphis, but I'm over here, and you know, all we knew was Elvis rented out movie theaters, and he'd go there at night, buy everybody Cadillacs for Christmas. What was it like to be in Graceland?
It was just, again, you know, such a rarefied experience to be loved by him. You know, when Elvis loved you, you never questioned that you were loved. I mean, this was a guy that was you know, deeply Southern, you know, and very affectionate. Like, when he said, I love you, he would get tears in his eyes and grit his teeth and just like, yeah, I'm going to get over here. I was like, you know, oh my God, he loves me. So you never felt more loved than by Elvis, you know. Yeah. And he was generous to a fault. I mean, there was one Christmas that he bought all the guys in his entourage Cadillacs. At the time, he had 13 guys in his entourage, and my son Brody goes, Mom, Elvis was the original pimp daddy, wasn't he? He had the original entourage, the original bling, you know. So he really was, yeah. But so one Christmas, he said, I'm buying everybody Cadillacs. And at the time, Cadillacs were $10,000 each. So he had these 13 guys, and anybody else want a Cadillac? You know, he just...
That's right, there was some woman.
He walked into a Cadillac dealership and there was a lady there with her daughter, and he says, hey, what are you looking at? Oh, nothing, we're just dreaming. Oh my God, Elvis, can I get your autograph? And he did. And so then, you know, 5 minutes later, he's buying this woman a Cadillac. She's a total stranger. I have to tell you a funny story, it's in the book, but Jennifer, my niece who's here, when Jennifer was born, it was 4:00 in the morning, and I'm living at Graceland with Elvis, and I said, oh my God, my niece is here. She finally was born. He said, get in the car, let's go. It's 4:00 a.m, we go to Methodist Hospital. She was born at Methodist Hospital. Doors are closed, of course. So they call, security calls the desk, and they say, and then Jennifer, after Jennifer was born, you know, I'd bring her up to the bedroom. Elvis was always, you know, kind of ensconced upstairs somewhere. So I would bring her up, I'd be holding her, I'd go, look, my little baby Jennifer, isn't she cute? And she'd go, I said, you're the only woman in the world that, you know, wasn't reaching for Elvis. When he would try to hold her, she would start to cry.
So did he burst into song a lot?
A lot, yeah. We sang a lot together.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah, because I grew up in a family that, you know, sang. We'd get together, and all my aunts and uncles and cousins sang and played guitar and piano and stuff. So I didn't have the voice that they have, you know. But Elvis would let me sing lead, and he would sing harmony. And we would sing like things like Amazing Grace and How Great Thou Art, all the right. Southern gospel Hems. Songs. Yeah, that we grew up on. And then my sorority songs. I was an AD Pi in upstate. So I taught him all my sorority songs. And there's a bootleg copy somewhere out there where Elvis and I are singing. I don't know if anybody's heard it, but you should pull it up because it's kind of funny. I'm kind of Southern. I'm going to listen to him singing this song. Is that me? But yeah, he was, it was like living a fairy tale, you know, and until it wasn't. You know, you start to grow up and realize, I never did a drug in my life, I still haven't, you know. It was very difficult to see someone that you love so much self-destruct. So I knew I was really given no choice but to leave.
How old were you when you essentially kind of pulled the plug on the relationship?
Well, I was 5 years old. He was a pedophile. So my story I told
you. You were 16.
I was 12. Right. Almost of age. No, I was 26. I was 26 when I left. So, and it was a really difficult. Someone asked me earlier how difficult was that. It was really difficult.
For the love of you.
Yeah, because he was the love of my life. I mean, but I'll tell you another thing, too. When you go through something so difficult, and I'm sure you've all probably experienced this, and you realize, you come out the other side and you go, I'm still standing, I'm still breathing, I can still smile. It's like, you know, you've gone through the fire, and it just makes you stronger. Mm-hmm. So those circumstances in life, things that the pain that you go through, Khalil Gibran was someone that Elvis and I used to read a lot, and he wrote a book called The Prophet and Sand and Foam. But one of his phrases was, the deeper the sorrow carves into the being, the more joy it can contain. And I believe that's true, you know. It's like those movies that George Burns did, God, you know, and they said, well, how do you know there's good and evil? And George Burns says, you know, you wouldn't know there was good if there weren't evil. You wouldn't know there was good if there weren't bad. You have to have something to compare it to, if it were just the same all the time. So I think we have to look at life like that. It's gonna, and I tell my kids too when they were little, got to be like a rubber ball. You got to bounce through life, you know, be resilient. You're going to hit rock bottom, and there's one way, and that's up. And then you're going to be riding high, and you got to know you're probably going to plummet back higher up. And, you know, but just ride it out. Just, you know, stay resilient.
That's the perfect
analogy. So it's kind of a self-help book. More than a tell-all.
Linda, what was your wake-up moment with Richard Foster?
With David.
David Foster.
Oh, him. Yeah. Oh, Richard.
Either or.
Let's see. Gosh, there were a few that I should have woken up way before I did. But David is a brilliant musician. I love David. Type A plus A plus A plus plus. He has a real type A personality. Brilliantly talented, but very the most difficult man that I ever lived with. I lived with three people in my life, and he was the most.
So when did you wake up and go?
Don't think so.
Yeah. Well, it took a lot of circumstances because. Again, I really felt almost debilitated by what Bruce came to me with. You know, when I was so deliriously happy with these two kids and my athletic, wonderful world champion husband, when he said, you know, I'm going to become a woman, and he started his transition 32 years ago and had done female hormones and done electrolysis and all this, I don't want to use the word crippled, but kind of debilitated by that.
Yeah,
I was very vulnerable. Yeah. And so I think I put up with a lot with David that I probably shouldn't have. He's a great guy in so many ways, but, you know, just kind of difficult to be married to. So unfaithful and disappeared a lot.
Oh, wow.
So
you went into it feeling
badly
about yourself.
Great guy, not a great husband.
Of course,
right? Yeah, and yeah. I think, yeah. But I don't want to say disparaging things about him because there are so many wonderful things to be said about him. He's very philanthropic. He donates his time and talent to so many different causes, and he is brilliantly talented, very charming, funny guy. If I could have still had that David, that would be, and Jennifer knows this, the David Foster that would be here tonight, everybody would be, oh my God, he's fabulous.
Right.
If I could have had that David Foster all the time at home, I'd still be married to him, probably. But you have people, you don't know someone unless you live with them.
Right.
So.
I do have one question. Getting
yes.
back to Graceland,
yes.
Did you ever want to redecorate the jungle room?
I decorated the jungle room.
Sure.
The jungle room didn't look like that.
No,
it was. Well, but let me just tell you this, that I had Elvis's dictate. I'm responsible for that gone all. But no, Elvis wanted to redecorate Graceland, so. We went, he and I went to Pier 1 together. We had this entourage with us and stuff. But he said, honey, I got this vision for my TV room down here. I kind of do a pretty good Elvis, don't I? I got this vision for my room here. He didn't call it the jungle room. He said, I want it to look like, like you're outdoors and like moss is growing up the side of the walls. And it's going to be green carpet down here. It's going to be green carpet growing up the walls. It's like it's going to be moss. And I said, honey, are you sure you want like green carpet going up the wall? Yeah, honey, now don't question me. I know what I want. And I want this heavy furniture and stuff. So we decorated the jungle room together, and then started getting called the jungle room. And then the living room and dining room, we decorated like a bordello. It was red, black, and gold. They have since turned it back into the original white. But there are some great photos of what he wanted, the red, black, and white. And then downstairs, I redecorated those two rooms. So, and that's still, they're still like they are. But yeah, we did that when I was living there. So
you're responsible.
I'm Sheba, queen of the jungle. And dating myself by remembering that. Right?
My parents told me about that.
Yeah. Okay. So kind to bring that up. Anybody else?
One last one. Are you single now?
Yeah, so funny you should ask. I have this necklace that I wear. I don't have it on tonight. But I have all these beautiful little anniversary rings, except they're bands. And I usually wear them around my neck because I had all these, stackable bands.
Yeah.
And one day I looked at them and I thought, those are too pretty to put away. When I got divorced from David, I put them away. So I put them on a chain, and then I started using them as my comedy routine. So I'd be on an elevator, and a guy would go,
Are those all your wedding bands? Okay, yes, they are. So, and then I decided I preferred to think of them as deceased. So then I became a widow. When people would ask me, I would have all these stories made up, and I still wear it sometimes. But I would say, oh, I accidentally dropped the hairdryer in the bathtub. Did you know oleander tea is poisonous? Yeah, this whole lost at sea, you know, shark ate him. Rex went out on the car, didn't mean to.
It's like an old Shirley MacLaine movie.
Yeah, exactly. Right? Just silliness.
When she had seven husbands.
So that was a long answer, but yeah.
And killed them all.
I'm single. I just wrote a country song called Mr. Now and Then.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's kind of funny.
But don't give up on love.
No, never, never. But you know, I've told a couple of my girlfriends today, I think I've become the person I wanted to meet.